Thank all of you who have chosen to join us this evening for a presentation on improving your success with grafting with acellular. I'd like to start with the topics that I'll cover this evening, and I will go into how this technique that I'm using now developed, how we arrived at what we do today, and it's been an evolution of treatment. And then I'll speak about the significance of keratinized tissue, because that's quite different from what we used to mean when we talked about keratinized tissue. If we're covering a graft completely or we're leaving it exposed, we'll have a different outcome, of course. And then I want to talk about current data regarding long-term outcome, because of course that would be important in any procedure we do for root coverage. And then I will finish with criteria for predictable results. What can we do to enhance our outcomes? Of course, throughout the presentation, I will be addressing that particular issue. So we'll start with development of the current technique. And if we go back in time and look at the original connective tissue graft method, I applied that to this particular problem. And in this example, you see a lower canine, and certainly in the lateral view, you see that it's outside the alveolar housing. And this is a rather complex site to treat. Used the technique as was described in 1985, and that was to create a flat vertical releasing incision at the dissect a site to receive the graft, and then suture a connective tissue graft onto that site covering the root, and then cover that graft with the overlying flap. So I advanced that tissue to cover the majority of the graft, and then sutured everything at the time with chromatograph suture. And then you can see the outcome at 2 weeks really is quite good. The graft has survived over the root. It's not complete root coverage, but it's very close. And then if we look at 2 years, we see we've been able to maintain that outcome. So a very successful treatment of a very difficult problem to connective tissue graft. Then if we look further down, 7 years, there's been a little bit of recurrent recession, but not much. And if we go a little further, 17 years out, it's at least as good as it was. 7 years, maybe a tiny bit better, actually. And then if we look at that compared to pre-op, we see, of course, quite a difference. Now, if we look closely at what's happened and look at the dotted line, that's a demarcation between the overlying mucosa that I used to advance over the graft and the graft itself that's become exposed. And the exposed part of the graft is showing up as keratinized tissue. But the apical border of that graft, of course, is beneath the mucosa. So there's a larger area of functional tissue than would be determined by simply looking at the gain of keratinized tissue. And this not only was true at 7 years, but it held true 10 years. Now, what I learned with connective tissue grafting was that if we did the standard technique of a horizontal incision and vertical releasing incisions, particularly in the lower anterior region, then we got significant retraction. So I modified the technique and tunneled the midline papilla. And if you'll see in this outline of the site prep, what I did is I made a horizontal incision here and dropped a vertical. And then I did the same thing over on the other side, horizontal incision and a vertical. And I tunneled under the midline papilla. And of course, I've created a recipient bed beneath all of this tissue. And because of tunneling midline, I have prevented retraction. I then moved these pedicles to cover the graft over the root. So I moved each one toward the midline, and then I brought the bottom corner up as well. And this resulted in complete covering of the graft. It's a little messy looking with suturing, but I have cheek retractors in every view, and you can see the stability that I've achieved simply by tunneling that one papilla in the midline. And that results in a stable wound. So at 2 weeks, we have a very nice result without exposure to the graft and without a protracted healing period. Now, if we look further at 4 weeks, you still see mucosa over that palatal graft. The connective tissue doesn't change the mucosa. And at 6 months, you still see it, and you can see a thick graft underneath that mucosa. And then you see the same thing at 5 years, where there is a complete recovery that's been maintained for the 5-year period, and yet the overlying mucosa still remains as mucosa. So there was a study by Harris and co-workers who evaluate connective tissue grafting, comparing a coronally positioned flap to a double pedicle flap or a double patella flap. And then the third procedure was the one I just showed you, a tunneling procedure with double laterally positioned flaps. So they compared those three techniques and found that there was a greater mean root coverage when they used the double patella flap or the tunnel method that I just showed you. This difference was even greater for sites that had more recession, equal to or greater than 3 millimeters, and also sites that had multiple adjacent recession defects. So this demonstrated that that technique involving a tunnel was superior to the envelope flap technique. Now, I made some other modifications as I went along with connective tissue grafting. Here I plan to treat the molar that has significant recession on the mesial root with lack of keratinized tissue. And I made a little wedge incision, as you see outlined in green, that will allow me to create a pouch that I can advance coronally. I felt like taking this wedge, as you see here, would allow me to bring that margin coronally more easily. And this preceded the tunnel method as I do today. But then I put the graft in that pouch and advanced the pouch margins to cover the palatal connective tissue graft completely. And then you see the outcome at 2 months. And what has occurred is that pouch margin has migrated apically a bit, retracted, and you see an exposure of the graft. There's very close to complete root coverage and a gain of keratinized tissue for the exposed portion of the graft, but the margin, the apical margin of that graft is actually under the mucosa. So you have a greater zone of dense functional tissue beneath that mucosa than you can tell from the gain of keratinized tissue. And we see the same thing holds true at 9 months and at 3 years. It's a very good outcome. Smaller gain of keratinized tissue than you would have if you had a completely exposed graft. But once again, I will address that more fully as we go along. Now this led to the way I'd started grafting with Alloderm. And I learned that tunneling the mandibular midline was very important in stability of the wound and stability of the site. So at this stage, I'm going to tunnel this midline and treating this one recession. But I will also treat all four incisors. And I incised the papillae adjacent to that midline because that's what I was doing at that time. And at the recipient site, completion and graft in place, you can see I've incised the papillae between the incisors and also between the lateral and the canine on each side, but tunneled the midline. And you notice the stability that you get in this region from having done that site prep. Also, the graft does not extend coronal to the CEJ nor over the papillary beds. This papillary bed is for the patella of the flap. So I then advanced that flap to cover the graft completely and sutured it, and I expect to have a good outcome. It's interesting to see that at 2 weeks, the graft actually became exposed. So you see a large exposed area here, and this may have some concern for those who consider this a membrane. But this is not a membrane, it's a graft, it has a blood supply, and so long as it's not infected, it should be fine. And we can see that at 1 year, there's no impact from having had exposure to the graft. There's very close, if not complete, root coverage of the tooth that had recession and had the graft exposure. And then at 4 years, that's been maintained over that time period. So the graft, the functional tissue is once again beneath the surface, and there was a gain of keratinized tissue where the graft was exposed secondarily, but there's functional tissue beneath the mucosa as well. Now then, if we look at another very early case, there's significant recession, lack of attached gingiva, and a cavity in both the molar and the premolar. These roots have been decayed, they have been excavated, restorations have been placed, and the restorations became dislodged, but they wouldn't stay in. The patient has a very shallow vestibule as well, so this created a little bit of a problem. And I treated this by making a pair of horizontal incisions in the patella between the molar and the premolar to allow me to advance this pouch coronally. This also gave me access to do the root preparation. And this was the type of papillary incision I made with palatal grafts, and I just simply applied that to the alloderm. And so I did a wedge here, like I showed you with an earlier molar, and I tunneled the papilla distal to the molar. Now I placed the alloderm graft in that pouch, advanced the tissue to cover it completely. And what I found at 6 weeks is there is a cleft where the graft met the papilla, where I made my incision papilla. I did not see this with palatal tissue, so that was a surprise. But the other surprise is this vertical wall of dense tissue that extends the vestibule. It actually extends the vestibule to the apical margin of the graft and provides stable tissue in this region. The mucosa will be mobile on top of that graft, but the site is stabilized by the dense tissue beneath the surface that's in contact with periosteum. And if we follow this at 3 months, there's still a little cleft you can see in this region. It's reduced. I did no plasty here. By 6 months, it's essentially remodeled. And if we look at it out at 1 year, we see that recovery has been maintained. And at 2 years, and 3 years, and at 5 years. So there's a very good outcome that's lasted quite well for this time period. And once again, there's this vertical stable tissue that extends beyond the genital junction. So I advanced from that to doing what I call the alternate papilla tunnel method. And in this method, I will incise one papilla, tunnel the next. So for treating this area, I'm going to incise this papilla, tunnel here, and incise this one. So I also tunneled between the molars, and I tunneled anterior to the canine. So you see the site prep, and you'll notice I have a cheek retractor in place. And even with the cheek retractor retracting the cheek and the lip away, it does not cause a great deal of retraction of the flap margin, even though I have dissected the recipient bed here. Now, I did this a Kelly-style incision. It's an oblique incision in the papillae. I will denude these papillae to create a recipient bed and advance the papilla of the pouch over that vascular bed after placing the graft, of course. So now you see the site sutured after placing an allograft graft, covering the graft completely. And this is an older technique, so it's using gut suture at the time. But I'd like you to notice that I have a cheek retractor in place. And in spite of the pull on that area with the cheek retractor, the grafted area is quite stable. And that's due to tunneling this one papilla. And if we look at the outcome at 4 weeks, there's very near complete root coverage. And at 5 years, there's a gain of keratinized tissue. If compared to the pre-op, you certainly can see a very significant difference in the width of keratinized tissue, as well as the root coverage that has been achieved and maintained for 5 years. So we go to the same technique in a little bit more involved case, where we now have molars involved and percations. You see on the lower first molar, significant recession and no attached gingiva on the root of the second molar, and very little keratinized tissue on the premolars as well. So I did the tunnel method once again, and you see it's sutured here, and there's an extra suture in the incised papilla here. So I incised this papilla, tunneled, incised, and of course that's the distal of the molar. I did not make an incision here. I tunneled under the tissue distal molar, and I tunneled under the papilla, course, here, mesial to the premolar. And all this is sutured in this example with 6-0 polypropylene, which is the suture primarily used. Now, if we look at pre-op compared to 2 weeks of healing, and there's a little slippage of the papilla that was incised at each side. The tunnel papilla, of course, is completely intact, but good healing at that point. And then at 2 years, very good outcome, but not quite as good root coverage adjacent to the incised papilla as there is adjacent to the tunnel papilla. A small difference, but still not quite as good. And if we look at 4 years, it's actually a bit better at 4 years. And at 7 years, root coverage has been maintained. And once again, maybe a little bit better at 7 years even than it was at 4 years. Incomplete root coverage on the molar, as you see here, the second molar, but that's about the same as we maintain at the 7 year point. And if we can see to pre-op, you see quite a significant improvement. And once again, it's been maintained for a 7 year time period. So what do we know about vertical releasing incisions with grafting? This is a controlled randomized clinical trial comparing an advanced flap, clonally advanced flap with and without vertical releasing incisions for treating multiple recession sites. And what they found is the group without vertical releasing incisions showed greater probability of complete recovery, a better postoperative course, and better aesthetics. And this is a paper by of Giovanni Zacchelli, published in 2009, so it's a relatively recent study. So this is evidence that a vertical leasing site preparation design is not as good as an envelope flap design. And of course, I'm using a tunnel design, which I think is superior still. Now then, if we look at the tunnel technique that I use today, what I will do in treating an area with multiple recessions is tunnel every propeller, because actually where you have a significant amount of recession, it gives you great access for doing the site prep, and you really don't need vertical incisions. So the first step, of course, is root preparation, and I often do the initial mobilization of this by doing the intracellular incision, followed by a blunt reflection to gain access to those roots so that I don't harm the marginal tissue during the root prep. But that's the root prep finished. And then I did the pouch preparation through the sulcus using a combination of blunt reflection and sharp dissection. And you can see that I've elevated the papillae as well. So I've created a site to receive the graft. And this is the size of the graft that I will place in this site and treat multiple teeth at one time. And I'll insert that through the sulcus. And that's the site with the alloderm inserted prior to suturing. I use a single suture technique now and suture the graft and the pouch at once. And there's generally one suture, and you'll see a knot here. I started at the posterior edge and worked my way forward to the anterior and then back, so there's a knot here. I wasn't satisfied with the adaptation at the canine, so I put a second sling suture in here, and that's why you see a knot in that location. And then you see the result, and this should say 3 months. This is a 3 month outcome. The next view will show you a 1 year, but that's very near complete root coverage in a site that had cervical notching with some enamel notching. So if you look at the top, you see a little enamel notch here and here as well, and you still see a little edge of that. And this is a 1 year post-op. And part of what I want you to see is the lack of significance of a change in keratinized tissue. You just have an absolutely natural appearing tissue with a very good root coverage. If not complete root coverage, it's extremely close and almost not detectable. So we'll look at a little bit more difficult case. This, in one sense, and easier in another, the tissue's not so bad here. In fact, a connective tissue graft has been performed here sometime in the past, but there is root coverage on all six anterior teeth. And this is class three recession because there's proximal root exposure. In other words, there's loss of papillary fill between the central and the lateral and between the lateral and the canine on both sides. You can see this a little bit better in the root prep view. So this is after doing root preparation, and you can clearly see the CEJ on the lateral incisor here, and you can tell that this is a class three, a mild class three, but nonetheless a class three recession. And then I place the graft in the pouch, and what you need to do with the old suture technique is push the graft down level with the pouch margin before you suture, as you see on this one tooth. It's not finished on the others. But you push it down level, and then you can suture everything at one time. Now, in this case, I've used sutures on the surface to advance that pouch with the dual suture method. And we see the finished suturing and the finished result. And here, there's complete root coverage, even where there was a class three recession involving the lateral incisor. Then if we compare side by side, you can see the change that has occurred using the tunnel method. The complete root coverage, natural looking outcome, the area that had no previous graft, of course, looks better than the site that had a previous connective tissue graft, which is a little bit bulky, but I don't think this is a big concern. Another case, and this is a very recent one where I used the new suture method, the single suture technique. And you can see quite a few teeth with recession from the canine through the second premolar. You can just see the second premolar at the edge of that view. So you can treat all of these at one time. In this example, I had to use two pieces of alloderm because one piece was not long enough to reach all the way. So the junction, and you can figure out where the best papilla is. Commonly, I do that between the are adjacent to the canine because the papilla is usually better there. So I might make a junction here or I might make one over here depending on the length of the graft I'm working with. And I don't suture that graft together first. I simply do it in the the suture technique, because that will draw the two ends together. And then finish the suture, and if you'll notice, there's a tie back here. And I also have a tie over here, and that's because I have separation of the papilla here. If the papilla does not have strength from facial to lingual, it will separate, and you'll have to suture it as a separate suture to your continuous length suture. As you see, it created no problem. You see the pre-op and the six-month post-op. And once again, post-operatively, there's essentially complete root coverage, very natural-looking tissue, functional tissue beneath the surface, no real mucogenital junction or gain of keratinized tissue or any of these things that we've had to be concerned about in the past. I particularly noticed this premolar at the six-month post-op compared with what you see at the pre-op, and you see a complete root coverage in spite of a cervical notch. In fact, all these teeth had cervical notches. Sometimes there's concern about a site that's a single tooth with a very deep recession. This is a canine with 8 millimeters of recession. And in tunneling, you just need to make sure you can mobilize the tissue sufficiently and bring it coronally passively. And that means significant dissection. So I will dissect this at least one tooth past the tooth I'm treating at each end. In fact, I typically do that unless it's very shallow recession. But here with significant recession, you have to do more extensive dissection to mobilize this tissue, so this can advance coronally passively. And then I'm able to advance it with a single suture technique. That's a single suture. But this papilla was a little bit incompletely adapted because of the degree of advancement. So I put an interrupted suture through that papilla to stabilize. Let me see the pre-op compared to 3 months post-op, and a little bit of a stain on the teeth at this point. And then at 3 years, complete root coverage has been achieved and maintained. There's a degain of keratinized tissue, and there's a lot of reasons this may occur, but it's just a natural look. It's not something I really measure, but I think you see a little bit of, even here, a potential retraction of the tissue a bit, exposing the graft secondarily, so you have an appearance of a gain of keratinized tissue. Now, sometimes the lower anterior can be quite difficult to treat with any technique. I like the tunnel procedure here. I do not do a phrenectomy first. I do a tunnel and graft first, and if the phrenectomy is needed, I simply dissect the frenum off of the graft. However, I don't think that will be necessary. In this example, there is no attached tissue whatsoever. There's a pretty significant depression between the roots here, and you see it here as well, and here, and also on the opposite side. Those will constitute undercuts, and they can be a little bit difficult to negotiate. However, you have significant recession, so you have access to reach these. I think you can do this with an intrasulcular methods, an all tunnel technique. So I grafted simply the two central incisors, and you see the sutured view, and there's a little cyanosis of the tissue at the stage, just a little bruising from the site prep. There was extensive dissection to mobilize this tissue and gain a passive advancement. And then we see the two-week post-op, where there is very good root coverage achieved at the early stage, very little swelling at that time. And then we go out to 6 months, and you see the connective tissue of the alloderm graft through the mucosa. Now, that's the frenum on the surface. This frenum is exerting no pull. You can see there's a little gloved finger here. So this is finger retraction pulling against this. And there's an extension of the vestibule and the stabilization of this area. So a phrenectomy is really not required. Now, if we go out to 3 years, you see a similar effect. And if for some reason this was a concern or presented some problem, you simply dissect it off of the graft at some time postoperatively. But I would never do that sooner than 6 months. And now we see the comparison of pre-op to 3 years. And if you notice the depression in this region here and here, and you see they're absent because the graft is filling in those areas, so you can see a distinct difference. Here the roots are very prominent, is another way to express that. And here they lose their prominence because of that thick connective tissue from the alloderm that is overlaying those roots. So what do we know about a tunnel procedure compared with a coronally positioned flap? Well, there was a study done to compare the two using alloderm, and the outcome was the coronally positioned tunnel procedure was found to be so much more comfortable for the patient that this group from Louisville, Kentucky, Henry Greenwell's group, considered the tunnel procedure to be the technique of choice. So when do we do papillary incisions? Now I've shown you the way I progressed from vertical incisions and flaps to alternate papilla tunnel to all tunnel, or tunneling all papillae, and yet you do need to incise papillae sometimes, particularly for augmentation grafting. If there is no recession and you're grafting to thicken tissue, it's very difficult to do a site prep through the sulcus with thin tissue and no recession. So that would be a reason. Thin tissue typically is a reason in doing augmentation grafting. So if you have shallow recession in thin tissue, that would be another reason to consider some papillary incisions. Another reason is if you have an area with shallow recession I mentioned, but also with irregular biography, you have undercuts that you can't engage. If you have shallow recession, thin tissue, and irregular bony topography, undercuts and whatnot, it's hard to negotiate those without injuring the margin of the pouch. So those would be reasons to do papillary incisions. I'll show you an example. If we look at this young man, he has very thin tissue, and look at the undercuts. I showed you similar things in the previous case, but here the recession is very shallow on the two centrals, and the tissue is thin in front of all six anterior teeth. So I'm going to graft all six teeth, and I'll prepare that with a tunnel method, but I incised two papillae. I incised the papilla between the lateral incisor and the canine on each side, and that gives me great access. If I open this, I have a W flap, if you want to look at it that way. So you have access to reach completely under the central incisor and to the midline from that opening. And I can go completely around the canine as well. Same thing for the other side. If this is wide open all the way to this point, I can easily reach under here and reach the central incisor and reach to the midline. So this gives me great access to negotiate these undercuts without harming the tissue, without perforating, without injuring the tissue, and certainly without cutting the margin. So I have the site prep completed at this stage. I'll now place the graft on the surface so you can see it, and then place that within the pouch. Once that's inserted, it's the other thing that's nice, this is a wide open area for insertion, because even if you can dissect this area, you still have to insert the graft, and it's difficult to insert it through a site that has no recession. But it's quite easy because there's a wide open area. Insert the graft, and then there's to suture it. And I'll suture that with a sling suture, single suture. So there's a knot right here distal to the canine. And I started here, worked my way to the far end, and then back, and I tied right here. But the problem is, at this point, I have these papillae I incised that are not well adapted and secure. So I need to put in additional sutures to secure them in that region. What I did in this case is I went through the papilla, recaptured the needle, went through the embrasure, around the canine, back to the facial, then I engaged right here, mesial to the canine, exited out the sulcus of the canine, and then went back around the tooth and tied here. So just a sling suture that is designed not to risk cutting the loops that are around this canine. So you have two loops around every single tooth with the sling suture. So you have to be careful that you don't cut them when you put it in to secure the papilla that you've incised. So that's the way I manage that area. And then you see a two-week post-op. After taking out the extra sutures, the knot you see here is the single continuous sling suture. And you see a nice result for a lower anterior region at an early post-op at 2 weeks and at 4 weeks. And notice how the suture sinks into the tissue. It leaves no marks at the margin. You still see the part where the knot was. So to take this out, you simply grasp this part of the suture. I don't take it out until 2 to 3 months. Then I'll cut the knot away and go over to the lingual side and find the loops behind these teeth, pull out at least one loop per tooth and cut it, and then pull the sutures out from the lingual. And we compare this simply to the pre-op and you can see the thickness that has been achieved and the elimination of the root prominences, indicating there's a thick layer of grafted tissue to cover all of this area. Let's talk about keratinized tissue. And what do we mean by keratinized tissue? And does it matter today? And yes, it matters if you mean you need to gain functional tissue. But let's talk about it for a moment. Let's take a look at this example. This is a case treated by Tony Sculia, and he loaned me these slides. You see the pre-op with recession, significant recession on one lower incisor, and no attached gingiva on that incisor, and probably not on the adjacent one. So Tony did a graft here, and you see the outcome, complete root coverage, but there's no gain of keratinized tissue. And this would disturb some people. So let's look at this. What is keratinized tissue? What do we mean? Well, we're talking about gingiva, and that is a dense collagenous connective tissue. So we use it interchangeably. We say we need keratinized tissue when we mean we need gingiva. What is keratinized tissue width? Well, that's the vertical dimension of keratinized tissue. It is from the gingival crest to the mucogingival junction. However, it includes both free and attached gingiva. So when we talk about keratinized tissue or keratinized tissue width, we're not distinguishing between attached gingiva and the total zone of keratinized tissue. And really, to say keratinized gingiva is redundant because gingiva is keratinized always, unless it's inflamed, and then it would be not keratinized because of the inflammation, and then it's hard to judge what you're gaining. I'll consider that more in a moment. So what do we mean when we say gain of keratinized tissue? Well, that's an increase in the keratinized tissue width following a surgical procedure. And that typically is the final keratinized tissue width after grafting minus what you had to start with. So if you had a millimeter of keratinized tissue before you graft and you had 4 when you finished, you gained 3. It's the indicator of success and a good indicator of success of a surface graft. If you place a free graft in an area and you put in a 6 millimeter graft and you end up with 5 millimeters, you have a pretty good outcome. But the problem is it might include gingiva that's generated from the periodontal ligament and marrow spaces, and it might include scar formation. So some things where we have a gain of keratinized tissue, it's not really gingiva, it's really a scar. Or it could be gingiva that comes not from the graft, but from the periodontal ligament and from the marrow spaces. It's certainly not an indicator of success of a covered graft, which is what we've been looking at. So let's talk about surface grafts and covered grafts. Surface grafts are free gingival grafts and grafts of other tissues or materials that are placed on a surgically created bed for the purpose of increasing the zone of keratinized tissue. Example would be a free gingival graft, as Prado published in 2003. And you can see on the left, there's very little gingiva. It's hard to tell exactly how much keratinized tissue is here. It's not measured really. Free graft is placed, and there's certainly a very significant amount of keratinized tissue at the end of that procedure. So that's been a very successful procedure. In fact, there's even been some root coverage. You can see there's a little bit of root exposure here, and there does not appear to be any at the end. And we can compare this to another method. This is tissue engineering. You can see minimal recession, but also minimal keratinized tissue, and a carrier with some type of tissue engineering technique has been applied, and the outcome you see here, actually there's a bit more recession afterwards, and it looks like there's been a significant change in the keratinized tissue, even from a surface graft. But these are surface grafts examples. Covered grafts, on the other hand, are connective tissue grafts, and grafts of other tissues or materials that are either partially or completely covered by adjacent recipient tissue, the tissue from the patient, with a coronally advanced flap, for example, or a double patella flap, or something of that nature. Now, if we look at an example, this is a patient I treated with a connective tissue graft some years ago, and you can see a canine that was surgically exposed and orthodontically positioned. It has no attached tissue, and it has a little bit of root exposure. So I place a connective tissue graft into a site where I have a very small horizontal and vertical releasing incision, very small on this other side as well, and covered so the graft. This mucosal flap retracted to this position, and there's an exposure of a portion of the graft, complete recovery and then gain a keratinized tissue. If we look at an alloderm graft that I placed on a different patient, a canine with a notch in the root surface and no attached gingiva, I did a pouch technique, advanced the pouch to cover the allodermal graft completely, and it's completely recovered. And it's really difficult to tell exactly where the mucogingival junction is, but certainly there's a gain of stable tissue at that area that looks like keratinized tissue. So let's look at the data. First, we'll look at the data involving surface grafts. And all of these studies are within the last 12 years. And we can compare free grafts to alloderm, and the first part of the chart shows that. Harris did a study where he found a gain of 4 millimeters with a free graft and also a gain of 4 millimeters with alloderm. Whereas we and Laurel found 5.5 approximately with a free graft versus 2.5 with alloderm as a surface graft. So it was not nearly as good as the free graft in this particular study. PD Prado's group compared a marginal free graft to a submarginal. A marginal means he excised all of the marginal tissue. A submarginal means he left whatever keratinized tissue was there, made the horizontal incision at the mucogingival junction, and placed the graft in order to retain any keratinized tissue that might be there. The outcome was about the same for both. I think there was no difference between these two statistically, but the figure is 4 millimeters. So if we look at this part of the chart, we can see the free graft is gaining between 4 and 5.5 millimeters, and we can see alloderm exposed was gaining between 2.5 and 4. So this one I didn't mention is a 3 millimeter just looking at alloderm. So a little bit less, but just keep these figures in mind, somewhere between 2.5 and 4, and this is somewhere between 4 and 5.5. There were a couple of studies by McGuire comparing free graft to tissue engineering, and we can see that free graft performed a bit better. 2.5 and 3.3 against 1.3. Mohammadi in 2007 published tissue engineering and found a gain of 2.8 millimeters. The interesting thing here in the Mohammadi study is he did a site prep only, where he simply prepared a site for a graft but did not place one on the site. And placing nothing on it, he gained nearly 2 millimeters. So this would suggest that you'll gain keratinized tissue simply from the marrow spaces paired on ligament and scar formation. So we can't say we're gaining it totally from the graft when we gain such a small amount. Now let's look at covered grafts, completely different site prep, different method. And we can look at against most of these studies are very recent. There's one from 94, but and 98, the others are in the last 12 years. Look at all of the figures. This is a connective tissue graft, partially covered. And these figures range from 1 to 2. In fact, there's only one of all of these studies that is at the 2 level. Otherwise, it ranges from 1 to 1.5. That's considerably less than we saw with surface grafts. If we look at a completely covered connective tissue graft, it's 0.9, or we'll call it 1. And if we look at completely covered alloderm, you see the figures here. Once again, it's 1. So there's no difference between completely covered alloderm and completely covered connective tissue graft regarding gain of keratinized tissue. If we look at the gain of completely covered connective tissue graft versus tissue engineering in a Wilson and McGuire study, it was 0.2 in each case, which would indicate that the overlying tissue probably did not retract at all. So this, I think, is something that we commonly see. So let's look at two examples. On the left, you see a site where I grafted the canine as a single tooth, and on the right, I grafted the canine as a single tooth. The left is 15 years after connective tissue grafting, and the one on the right is 3 years after alloderm grafting. And they both look as I would expect, because I've covered the graft completely, so the tissue that you see where I grafted looks no different than the adjacent sites, because all the tissue matches in both examples. If I had used alloderm tissue here and alloderm here, you'd see exactly the same outcome. It's not the nature of what's under the tissue, it's the nature of the tissue that's over the graft. So what we need to understand is that if we graft in an area in a tunnel method and cover the graft completely, then the surface appearance will not tell us the nature of that underlying tissue, because it does not change because the graft is under it. So, and carry that a little further and finish this topic. If you look at this example, you can see this is a little area where a free graft had been placed. So there's a gain of keratinized tissue there. I think designed to stop the recession that was occurring on that one incisor. I grafted all six lower teeth, and I did it with alloderm in a tunnel method, and you see the outcome of 6 months on height, where there is incomplete root coverage because it's class three recession, but it's very close to complete. And there's an enhanced thickness of the tissue and a change in vestibular form. In fact, if we change this to black and white, you can see it better. I think you can see the thickness of the tissue better when you don't have the color influencing it. And if you look at the vestibular form, you see pre-op and look at it post-op, you can see the extension of the vestibule. And this is a displacement of mimic muscle, that's your facial expression muscles. They're easily displaced, not displacement of the mentalis muscle. But you can regain or create a vestibular space where there is alveolar bone. And that's what has been accomplished here. So let's go back to Tony Skoulian's case. This is his pre-op I showed you earlier, and his tunnel preparation to treat this site. Only advancing, the plan is to chronally advance that tissue over a graft. And this is a powerful graft. This is powerful connective tissue that he used here. And then he sutured it within the pouch, advanced that overlying tissue to cover the graft completely. And then you see the six-month outcome, which he and I agree. We discussed this case, and he was kind enough to loan me these photos. We both agree this is an excellent outcome. The goal of this procedure was not to simply gain keratinized tissue, but to gain functional tissue beneath the mucosa, do it in a fashion that is most likely to survive and that is most comfortable for the patient. They have an excellent outcome. It's just that the final appearance doesn't let you know for certain that this area has been treated. To me, that's a positive because the aesthetics actually is better. That's compared to pre-op. So, if we look at the evidence, I've showed you some already, but the evidence for equivalent gain of keratinized tissue with alloderm versus powerful tissue, there are three randomized controlled clinical trials in highest order of evidence. There is a meta-analysis as well, published in 2005, looking at all the data, and these concluded that there is equivalent gain of keratinized tissue between alloderm and connective tissue grafts. So let's look a little further, one more example. I'm going to treat the molar and the premolar where there's minimal keratinized tissue. I have a graft in the tunnel, advanced the pouch to cover it. And you see the outcome at 2 months. And now I will give you a closer view of pre-op in 2 months. And we look at the amount of keratinized tissue before and after. I may have been generous on the before. There's very little there in that particular spot. And it's enhanced at the 2 month time frame. But that little bit is not as important as what's beneath all of that mucosa. And if we take a biopsy of this area, we'll find a layer of connective tissue adjacent to the periosteum and beneath that overlying mucosa. So we'll take a closer look at that. And what I'm suggesting to you is that you have this wide zone of dense collagenous connective tissue that provides the function. And over that is the mucosa. We're going from oral sort to tooth root. And that tissue, this dense collagenous connective tissue, whether it's alloderm or powerful tissue, does not send a signal to the epithelium until it keratinizes. It can't send the signal through mucosa to that epithelium. That does not happen. Nor is there some influence of a loosely arranged tissue to convert a dense tissue to loose, nor a dense to convert the loose to dense. So there's not an influence of one tissue on the structure of the other. So what can we conclude about keratinized tissue gain? It's derived from primary grafting, how much you leave exposed when you do the procedure. Secondary graft exposure, and that means of a retraction of the overlying tissue, how much graft becomes exposed early or even late with muscle fall on the site. A reestablishment of the mucogenital junction in the lower arch, I think, creates a appearance of a gain of keratinized tissue. Tissue generated from the periodontal ligaments and meristases, this can contribute to secondary gain of tissue as well, and scar formation. All these things will contribute to gain of keratinized tissue. The thing to understand, though, that it's not an indicator. Gain of keratinized tissue is not an indicator of success of covered grafts. So the advantage of using an allograft, using alloderm, is that a powerful donor is not necessary. This means that a lot more patients are going to seek treatment because they have fear of having powerful surgery. There's reduced patient discomfort. So that means when the patient goes back to the referring dentist and says this was not a bad procedure, that dentist is not disinclined to send more patients. Whereas if the patient goes back and says, gosh, you know, that was a miserable experience, that can impact the referrals of future patients. However, you must have root coverage that's equivalent to a connective tissue graft. And if we look at that a little further, we find that with alloderm, there are 4 randomized controlled trials. We're not considering all of the case studies or case series or case reports, but randomized controlled trials that show that alloderm and palatal tissue result in the same degree of root coverage. This is not true for alternative allografts. The studies to this level do not exist. There also are 2 systematic reviews. One, OATS, is from the Award Workshop in Clinical Periodontics from 2003, and a more recent one, 2010, from Chambrone, and they each found equivalent root coverage between alloderm and palatal tissue. There's also the meta-analysis that I showed earlier, Gapsky, Parks, and Wong, published in 2005. So we have really the highest order of evidence indicating that you get equivalent root coverage between alloderm and palatal connective tissue grafts. So our last topic before we close is long-term outcome. And I'll be taking questions from you in a moment if you've written some down or would like to ask, you have that opportunity in a moment. But long-term outcome is very important. And for a long time, we had only the one study from Harris published in 2004. This was a short-term and long-term comparison of root coverage with alloderm and a connective tissue graft. And this study was a retrospective comparative study, different from a controlled trial, of course. And he had 25 consecutively treated patients in each group. The study of alloderm included the first 25 patients treated by the author. And the palatal group, of course, had 25 patients treated at the same time, 25 consecutive patients, and with a procedure he had about 15 years experience with. He took clinical measurements at baseline, 1 year, and 4 years. So the findings were that the alloderm root coverage at 1 year was 93%, meaning that there was 0.2 millimeters of recession at the end of the 1 year, so there's a tiny bit of root exposure. At 4 years, there was 66% mean root coverage, meaning there was 1.1 millimeters of recession or root exposure at that point. So there was a 0.9 millimeter change over that 4 year time. The connective tissue grafts stayed stable, 97%, and it collected 0.1 millimeter of root exposure at both 1 year and at 4 years. However, there were differences between the groups. The alloderm group had tillers, and there were no molars in the connective tissue group. Certainly, you can expect to have better root coverage on single-root teeth than you do on molars in general, so this could have been a factor. In addition to that, there were 4 failures, total failures, or essentially total failures in the alloderm group, and this is understandable because of the learning curve. But the important thing here is, if you discard the 4 failures, you'll find there's no statistical difference between the groups. I think this is an important point that I've not heard mentioned before. Now there's another study more recently, 2010, from Nichols group, includes Peter Retzke, who published one of the early papers on connective tissue grafting in, I believe, July of 1985 in Journal of Periodontology. And this one is 10 years after connective tissue grafts and guided tissue regeneration for root coverage in your results. This study had 15 patients with 38 recession defects randomly assigned to receive one of the 2 methods. So this is different from a retrospective study. Clinical measurements were taken at baseline, 6 months, and 10 years. The findings included 90 patients and 24 sites available for assessment at 10 years. There's a fall off, which is understandable. They had a mean root coverage for connective tissue grafts at 6 months of approximately 73%. And at 10 years, it dropped to 44%. So this is about a 30% decline, very similar to approximately a 30% decline seen for Alloderm in the Harris report that I mentioned just before this one. And another more recent one, this one is a randomized controlled trial, which again reaches the highest order of evidence from Moslemi and co-workers, published about 1 year ago. And this was comparing Alloderm to connective tissue grafts with 5-year follow-up. They had 16 patients with bilateral recession. One side received Alloderm, the other side received a connective tissue graft. Clinical measurements were taken at baseline, 6 months, and 5 years. Their findings were no difference in root coverage at 6 months between the two groups. The figures were 85% for Alloderm and 6% for connective tissue grafts, but statistically, no difference. There was no difference between the two groups at 5 years either. They both declined. Alloderm to 55%, connective tissue graft to 40%. They both declined at 30%. So we're starting to see that figure repeating itself. The interesting thing here is they looked at what caused the relapse. They looked at the patients who had relapsed, because we're talking about mean root coverage. So some had better, some had worse. The ones that had worse, they looked at why. And they found a statistically significant relationship between relapse and brushing technique. Certainly this makes sense, and it's something that should be apparent. If you have good root coverage at 6 months or a year, why do you lose it later? If you don't control the brushing technique, that's one reason. They looked further and found that the method of surgery was not related to relapse. So that brings us to our final slide, and that's criteria for predictable results. And then we'll be taking questions for the remaining time, and we can go over a little bit if you wish. First of all, this technique requires proper instrumentation. Don't try this with conventional instruments. You need microsurgical instruments. If you know, I've designed some instruments that I think are very helpful in performing this procedure. And I would suggest that you might want to try them, and I think it will enhance your outcome. I believe the tunnel technique is the best for using an allograft. I think that the techniques that we use for connective tissue grafts are quite good for connective tissue grafts, but they're not as good for allografts. I believe the tunnel technique is a superior technique for either one. In fact, when I'd use palatal on occasion, I use the tunnel technique for it as well. So the tunnel technique has limitations, and you occasionally will need to open up a pillow for access, as we mentioned earlier in this talk. You need to cover the Alloderm completely. If you leave the Alloderm exposed, it is, however, I think if you cover it to within a millimeter, if you have a millimeter or less exposed, in other words, there should be no consequence, no bad consequence from that. But if you have more exposed, it doesn't do as well. Palatal tissue would do well exposed up to 3 millimeters. So if you can't cover the graft completely, then you probably want to consider using a palatal tissue. I would recommend prophylactic antibiotics with any pouch technique, whether you're using palatal tissue or an allograft. I think they're more subject to a small degree of contamination that can cause infection, and antibiotics are helpful in preventing that. I use prophylactic antibiotics for 10 days with my tunnel techniques. You need to, of course, maintain proper brushing technique. In fact, you should start that before you do the grafting technique. You must instruct the patient, you must evaluate what they're doing, change it to a method that won't be damaging, and then reinforce that throughout the postoperative period and long-term, if you want to have a good long-term outcome. Because as we saw from the Moslemi paper, a return to a scrubbing technique is what they found, resulted in a recurrent recession. And then you need to have realistic expectations. You can't cover all roots. In fact, you can't cover all roots 100%. You can't cover 100% of all roots. So you need to look at the site and determine what's realistic in that site and recognize that your primary reason that you're grafting in most cases is to gain resistant tissue so that you don't have a future recession. Where aesthetics are critical, you'd like to cover it completely, and then it becomes much more important. But I think even there, you have to recognize what you can and cannot do. I like to use a rule of 3 millimeters from the papilla tip. I can typically bring a gentle margin to within 3 millimeters of the papilla tip. But the guideline is not foolproof, and you can beat it sometimes, actually. but it's a good guideline. So that completes our program. Thank you for your attendance. We have time for questions, and we will put up a window where you can type in your questions, and I'll answer those to the best of my ability. So once again, I want to thank BioHorizons for hosting this webinar, and thank all of the attending, and I'm ready for your questions. Anyone who wishes to type in the chat window, if you see the chat window, you can type a question at that location. Not seeing a question popping up at this moment. I would like to just suggest a couple. Some people ask about such things as what kind of suture do you use. I showed polypropylene suture, and I'm using a 6-0 polypropylene suture as my single suture technique. I have a question on here now. When you reflect your tunnel flap, but I would say pouch apically, are you against the bone or just submucosal? Excellent question. It's very important that you are against the bone always. In the beginning of that preparation for the graft, I do an intrasulcular incision, and that's from the base of the sulcus to the crest of bone. I do a full thickness elevation apical to the mucogenital junction. And then I do sharp dissection with a modified Orban knife, and I keep that blade against the bone because you have to have an immobile base or you won't get the outcomes that I showed you. So you'll dissect that to staying in contact with the bone so that you have a stable base to place the graft against. So it is by definition, a split thickness dissection once you start the sharp. And you have to do sharp to get passive mobility. But that is like a 95-5 split. It's not 50-50. So you want to stay against the bone, so you're immediately super periosteal. Now, what do I use for root preparation? Root preparation is just simple, light root preparation. I use a Younger Good 7-8 curette. But if I need to do reduction of sharp edges from cervical notches or from attraction lesions, if you believe in those, or remove a shallow restoration, use a Vario 750 ultrasonic unit, and then I'll finish with a Younger Good 7-8 curette. And whenever I do root prep, I finish after the root preparation with 17% EDTA solution to remove the smear layer. I use EDTA solution because it doesn't harm the blood supply or burn the tissue, and yet remove the smear layer. Do I use Copac? No, I don't use any dressing on the facial. Occasionally on lingual surfaces for lingual grafting, I'll use a dressing because I think it's necessary to protect the graft lingually. But facially, I think the dressing creates a problem. It holds plaque beneath it. It gives the patient a false sense of security. And I think it's better to have access to the site to treat it postoperatively. For example, for a long time we've used chlorhexidine rinses, and if you have a dressing in place, the rinse doesn't really get to the site and doesn't eliminate the bacteria. So I think it's not a good idea to use Copac. We use an antioxidant gel now rather than chlorhexidine rinse postoperatively, and I want that to reach the grafted site, so I don't like dressings. What do you use to avoid the alveolar from getting above the CEJ? Are you suturing it separately? How? Well, great question again. If you do a tunnel method and you don't incise any papillae, it's no problem. The graft really stays where it should stay almost without any effort. However, using the single suture method that I told you that I use, it's very important to insert the graft completely into the pouch so that the coronal border of the graft is level with the coronal margin of the pouch. And you put the suture, you put the needle through pouch margin and the graft at one time with both of them at the same level, capture the needle, and then you go around the tooth and complete your sling suture, and you draw both the graft and the pouch coronally at the same time. You can't draw it over the CEJ, it won't happen. But it's really important not to have the allogeneic graft, the coronal to the CJ or over a papillary bed where you've incised a papilla, and that's more likely to happen. You simply just, you have to direct that graft to where you want it and not pull it too far coronally with your suture. It just is pulling the suture too tight. So it's just it's a matter of maintaining tension correctly and positioning the graft and making sure it stays where you want it as you do your suturing, and when you tie your knot to make sure the margin stays where you want it. And then when you suture a papilla, you'll suture the papilla without going through the graft, of course, and you either would suture it through that papillary bed or suture it so that it's active that papillary bed with a sling suture. Do you suture the graft itself or just the overlying flap? I think I answered that in a way, but let me explain it again. In the beginning, in fact, with all of my grafting in the past, I would suture the graft first, stabilize it exactly where I wanted it, no matter what site prep method I used. And then I would cover the graft secondarily, maybe with a coronally advanced flap, now with a coronally advanced pouch using tunnel technique. But I would suture the graft first, cure it precisely, then I would coronally advance the tissue to cover it completely without penetrating the graft. What I'm doing now is a single suture method where I suture the pouch margin and the graft margin at the same level, meaning that I want the graft level with the pouch margin, and advance them both together. That take is published, and it would be easier to look up the publication. I published that in the International Journal of Periodontics and Restorative Dentistry in 2010, I believe October issue, so you can find that. Is the rate of success better in the upper teeth compared to lower teeth? I would say probably yes. I would say it's easier to get success in the upper than the lower. Let's put it that way. The lower is more subject to retraction. The patient has to be more. It's easier to have something interfere with your complete recovery on the lower than the upper. But otherwise, I treat the lower routinely. Probably treat the lower more often than the upper. Treat the lower anterior as well as lower posterior, and they should all work well. The thing that leads to success is adequate dissection and mobility of the pouch, and good suturing. So, I mean, there's a lot of little nuances that are important in achieving an outcome. So I tried to cover a number of things and show you how the technique developed. I think the tunnel technique is better than any other technique to achieve success, but you have to dissect it properly. Dissection properly means dissection enough to gain passive mobility. So that means you typically dissect at least one tooth past the teeth you're treating. It would be unusual that you wouldn't do that. And that dissection must stay against the bone. So these are some of the things that lead to success. What prescription for post-op swelling? If you're treating a lot of teeth in the lower, you're going to get more swelling than you typically get in the upper. So I would use, I use platelet-rich plasma. If you use platelet-rich plasma, it has an impact on postoperative swelling. If you don't use platelet-rich plasma, then I would use a steroid dose pack because that will reduce the swelling. And that needs to be used prior to the surgery. You can't wait a day or two later, and once swelling has occurred, I use steroids. So you start that before. And you can either do a dose pack, or you can do it IV, or you can do it IM. So there's a lot of ways you do IV or IM at the time of surgery. I would start the dose pack prior to the surgery. You always use PRP and PPP. Yes, I do. As a matter of, well, no, I don't. I always do when it should be used. And my take on that is that basically PRP is making a patient heal like a teenager. So if they already are a teenager, I don't use it. I think they heal well enough without it. So I won't use PRP in someone under 21. 21 and over, and I won't use it for a single tooth because I don't think it's necessary. But I typically am treating multiple teeth, will use PRP, and I think it's particularly important in the lower arch, which will swell more. What do you do if the suture for the lying flap is loose, now the derm becomes exposed? Gosh, good question. It's more of a hypothetical question because it shouldn't be loose. I use polypropylene suture, it doesn't get loose. If you will do a 3 millimeter bite, and what that means is if you're grafting and you're doing a suture, a single suture method, you're going through the overlying tissue and the graft. I will do my needle penetration 3 millimeters off of the margin. In other words, apical to the margin of the tissue. If you do that, it should not pull through for one thing, and that's one thing that would make it come loose. If you tie that properly, you shouldn't have a slippage. So properly means that when you are ready to tie, if you will do 3 throws clockwise, that'll hold. If you're using a 6-0 polypropylene suture, it'll slip if you use just 2 throws. So I do 3 throws and tie that down gently, and then 1 throw counterclockwise to lock it, and then 1 more clockwise. So the notch should not slip. There's just no reason it should slip much. It's possible that with lower anterior teeth that maybe your suture is slipping off of the cingulum a little bit and getting a little bit loose, but I just don't do that. So it's really hard to answer, but you're saying, what would you do? And the outer rim becomes exposed because the flap is loose. I mean, that just shouldn't happen. I mean, that would happen if it happened early in the procedure. It won't become exposed late in the procedure because it's starting to integrate. So I don't see that happening. But I think that alveolar exposure, if it's simply exposed and it's a week or two out, it has a blood supply, you simply need to keep it clean, make sure it doesn't become infected or damaged, subject to damage from brushing or eating, so the patient has to be more cautious. And typically by 4 weeks, it has completely recovered. I think that best way I can answer that. How many days for corticosteroid? Well, I use a steroid dose pack, and it's 6-5-4-3-2-1. So it's 6 days, and you start the morning of if you're doing an afternoon surgery, or the morning before if you're doing a morning surgery. I like to take all of the tablets at once, have the patient take them all at once, and I like to start in the morning because sometimes it causes insomnia, so that's a reason for that. You say you remove your sutures after 2 to 3 months. Yes, I like to leave the graft suture, or if I'm doing a single suture technique, the entire suture, initial suture, or 2 to 3 months. I think it is good to maintain some support for the site until there's a little bit more integration and attachment. I don't know what the time frame is, but I think it's longer than 2 weeks. And maybe 6 weeks is okay. We're generally going at least 2 months, and sometimes we'll leave it 3 if we think it might be beneficial. And we get no complaint from the patient. The sutures really are hard to see. They sink into the tissue. They really don't bother the patient. Now, if I use surface sutures or an extra suture someplace or other, I may remove that one at 4 weeks, but I'll leave the main suture for 2 to 3 months. It looks like questions have slowed down. I certainly appreciate your attention. Somebody even said thank you at the end of their question. I appreciate that. I enjoy presenting this material. I like grafting. I like trying to improve the techniques that we use and make them nicer for the patient as well as a nicer outcome. But I think a more pleasant experience for the patient is important. And I think we're there. I think that we should not be using vertical incisions. I think we should primarily be tunneling. And I think that we can improve what we do. We can continue to improve. So you must think so too. That's probably why you tuned in. So I thank you for your attendance. And I think we're going to end the session just about 10 minutes over. So I hope I didn't keep you too late into your dinner hour. So thank you for your attendance, and good luck to you with your draft. Thank you.